Welcome to this presentation on process discovery. In this presentation, we will show you how you can complement your process discovery methods using formal concept analysis. This presentation is presented to you by Jonas Poelmans on behalf of Dr. Edward Peters from Open Connect Systems and Professor Guido De Dene from the Catholic University of Leuven. Process mining and process discovery were introduced in the late 1990s. They were introduced to gain understanding in as-is processes, to extract process models from event log data, and to identify deficiencies, root causes for problems, and potential remedies. Traditionally, process mining consisted of applying statistical approaches such as Six Sigma and Lean management to such event log data. They, however, were often limited to finding the average or most common process. Another technique which was often applied is called PetriNet models. PetriNet models are, however, good and compact representations to discuss and show and build a process model. However, for mining processes, they have their limitations. In particular, in cases of large process variations and exceptions, they will fail in extracting the most interesting information from these event logs. Therefore, process discovery was introduced. It will, on top of finding the average process, it will also allow you to extract process variations and exceptions. One method which can be used to this purpose is hidden Markov models. In our research, we complemented formal concept analysis to the hidden Markov models. Hidden Markov models were used to identify value leaks and understanding the average process and its variations. FCA, on top of that, was used to find the root causes for these value leaks, but also we found that with FCA, it is possible to provide more correct probabilistic information for process transitions. In particular, we will show that many-to-many transitions in process representations are places for ambiguity in the process model, which lead to incorrect path probabilities being calculated, for which FCA can be a remedying solution. Concept lattices turned out to give the correct probabilistic information even in the presence of many-to-many transitions, compared to hidden Markov models and other process mining techniques. The starting point for each process mining exercise is an event log. Each log record has an actor who is responsible for the event type affecting one or more object type instances. For example, in this slide, you can see about 100 timestamps. Each timestamp shows you which log event is affecting which object. At timestamp 1, log event A1 affects object 1. At timestamp 2, log event A1 affects object 2. At timestamp 3, log event B1 affects object 1. This table is very useful for extracting transitions. For example, for object 1, we have the transition, or the sequence of events A1 and B1. Then C, then D1, and then E1. All these sequences can then be fed as input to a hidden Markov model algorithm, with the result a process model. But it is also possible to analyze this kind of information with formal concept analysis. In this case, the starting point is a cross table. The attributes are transitions, namely from starting state S to state U1, for example, from starting state S to state U2, from starting state S to state U3, and so on. The objects are in the rows 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. The crosses indicate which transitions occur for which objects. For example, the transition from event S to event U1 is valid for objects 1, 2, 7, 8, 9, 10, 15, 16, and 19. The same information can be represented as a concept lattice or a line diagram, which you can see in the left bottom of this slide. The information in the table can be obtained from this lattice in the following manner. For example, take the concept in the left bottom corner with objects 14 and 17. We can follow the lines upwards and we can find the transitions V2F, CV2, U4C, and SU4. Vice versa, if we have a transition, we can find which objects are affected by this transition by following the lines downward. For example, take U4C, so from event U4 to C, we have objects 17 and 14 and 20 and 60. 20 and 6, I'm sorry. On the right side, right bottom side, you can see exactly the same concept lattice, but this time with probabilities. The probabilities indicate the likelihood of this transition to occur for a non-seen event sequence. It will turn out that these probabilities, which are encircled in yellow, actually correspond to the first order probabilities in the Markov models. The probabilities encircled in green turned out to be the probabilities for the normalized Markov model, which we will see very shortly. Here we see a non-normalized hidden Markov model with one many-to-many transition in the center. Event C has four inputs, namely U1, U2, U3, and U4, and has two potential outputs, V1 and V2. If we look at the probabilities to go from S to U1, S to U2, S to U3, and S to U4, you can immediately recognize the same probabilities which were present in the top layer of the concept lattice in the previous slide. This place C is, however, an ambiguity in the model, which will lead to incorrect path probability calculations. Therefore, this slide shows you a normalized hidden Markov model. In this diagram, event C has been cloned four times. C1, C2, C3, and C4 now all have one input and two possible outputs. If we look now at these transitions again, namely the transitions for the normalized model, we can see in the bottom of the screen again the lattices, and we can see that these probabilities remained unchanged. It turns out that FCA is robust to these many-to-many transitions, which will lead to incorrect path probability calculations in the hidden Markov model. Let us look at the model precision, which is obtained with non-normalized hidden Markov models and normalized hidden Markov models. The model without cloning, if we take sequence S to U3, U3 to C, C to V2, V2 to F, this has a probability of 11.11% in the model without cloning. If we take sequence S to U3, U3 to C, C to V1, and V1 to F, this has a probability of 13.88%. If we now look at the model with cloning, which gives the exact path probabilities, These probabilities are 10% and 15% respectively. These are also the probabilities which we could derive immediately from the concept lattice, even in the presence of these many-to-many transitions. Of course, you could argue that these errors are small, but if we are going to apply this to big data with millions of records, these errors can be very significant. If we now build a concept lattice for the higher order pod probabilities, the concept lattice in the bottom shows you immediately the probabilities for these higher order transitions. So we used as attributes the higher order transitions, which gives you the pods from start to U1 through C through V1 to the end state, or from S starting to U2 to C to V1 to the end state, and so on. All these possibilities are used as attributes, and crosses indicate for which objects they are valid. The probabilities can immediately be derived from the concept lattice. Another example is the following event log, which was slightly modified from the literature. You have several transitions and crosses indicating for which objects they are valid. The Markov model distilled from this event log is shown in the left bottom of the screen. You can notice immediately a few things about this Markov model. First of all, its probabilities are not consistent with the probabilities in the concept lattice on the right. This is caused by two many-to-many transitions, namely at point A and at point C in the Markov model. Also, you can see that the Markov model is too generic. It allows for several event sequences which are actually not present in the input data. Therefore, this model should be normalized. After normalizing the model, namely by replacing A and C by A1, A2, C1, and C2, we obtain the following model. The probabilities are now consistent with the probabilities in the concept lattice. From this we learned that even in case the model was not normalized, that the concept lattice still gave us the correct probabilities, compared to the hidden Markov model, which gave us incorrect probabilities. Another example, which we borrowed from the process mining literature, is the following. This shows you a PetriNet, and you have these squares. The squares contain certain activities, which are performed during a process. They are labeled as A, B, C, D, E, F, and so on for convenience. You can see immediately that this PetriNet can be useful for, in a compact way, representing a process, discussing it with different stakeholders in the organization. However, if we want to apply this to an event log containing a lot of process variations and exceptions, we will not be able to extract the most important and relevant information. Also, there is a many-to-many transition, namely at point I, there are four possible inputs and four possible outputs. Again, here normalization is needed to prevent incorrect probabilities from being calculated. This concept lattice shows you the first order transition lattice for this example. The attributes are the first order transitions. This means transitions involving just two events. And we see immediately four process variations. They are encircled in orange, green, red, and black. If we will apply this normalization procedure to the Markov model, we will obtain the following four variants. 1, 2, 3, and 4. Actually, it is necessary to represent each of these variants separately. This is an unambiguous representation, free of many-to-many relationships. And if probabilities will be calculated based on these models, they will also be correct. I have no time to go deeply into these examples. However, for anybody who is interested in the full explanation of these, this last example, I would kindly like to refer you to our publication in the EEML proceedings. And if there are any kind of questions, emails, proposals for collaboration or so on, feel free to contact either me, Edward, or Guido on one of the email addresses presented in the paper. Thank you for your attention.
Is dat zo van. En op een gegeven moment is dat een onrust de andere draag op hun plaats te
zeggen. Ja, dat kan geen kwaad. Maar als je dat zo.
Oké,
okay. Nog een keertje. Wat een avond, delegaat.
Zit hier stoel, ik ga daar toch eens naar die vijzen moeten kijken. Ja. Ik vind dat hij hoe langer hoe braver zijn poten zet.
Nou, we gaan toch binnenkort die andere stoel stellen ook, dus.
Dat is ook goed om de resultaten te
vallen. Ja, en dan end recording.